Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Club East St. Paul, and thank you so much for coming. Just a couple of announcements before our speaker here. Our next luncheon is on the third Wednesday, April 15th, where we'll have tech guru Dan Mosha share his insight on automating your business and improving customer service through automation. Please check out clubby.com for videos of previous speakers and events at all our locations, Hudson, Minneapolis, and St. Paul. I really appreciate the opportunity to host these gatherings and educational material, and that's due to a large part to our sponsors. They are the University Club, Olson Thielen CPAs, a locally based full-service accounting and consulting firm, and Mike is here. Here we go. Schwegman, Lundberg, and Wussner, IP attorneys for high-tech companies. The Irish Titan, a digital agency helping companies with e-commerce and digital strategy. Sunbelt, Business Brokers of Minnesota, helping you buy and sell businesses. And Peggy is here. There we go. And my company, providing identity theft and legal plans for consumers, small businesses, and employees. We're always open to new sponsors, so please come see me if you have an interest in that, working with us.
John, can I make an announcement?
Yes, please do.
Irish Titan, for those of you that don't know, Darren Lynch, isn't here today and probably won't be here for a while because they have two company holidays of the year in addition to the local ones. And one of them is Friday, which is, anybody know what Friday is?
Yeah, that's right. He's here in spirit, in a drunk spirit, but it's here. I've actually had about six people recommend our speaker to me many, many months ago. Those same people have heard him speak multiple times and have really enjoyed his presentations. My friend Brad has seen him four separate times, so I'm excited to see our speaker here for the first time. A little bit about his background. He is a number one best-selling author, speaker, and founder of Outperform the Norm, a leading program for high achievers who are driven to perform their best personally and professionally. He has authored eight best-selling books, that's insane, has a master's degree in sports psychology, is an adjunct professor at St. Olaf University, and regularly consults with top-performing executives, sales leaders, and entrepreneurs, as well as elite athletes. For fun, and because he's a little crazy, he's completed 5 Ironman triathlons, 27 marathons, and a 100-mile ultra marathon run. I've done one marathon, so. Please welcome Scott Welly.
Thank you, Chum. Am I good audio-wise? Sounds like I'm fine. Good afternoon, everyone.
Afternoon.
Yes, all right. I appreciate you all taking time out of your busy schedules to be here. I'm guessing this is going to be a little bit of a different presentation than maybe you've heard here in the past. Through that lengthy bio that Chum just read off, I don't know if you got, but my background's in sports psychology. And I got my start working with elite and professional level athletes on the mental side of what it takes to be able to train and compete at that highest level. And sometimes, you know, people will say, well, okay, Scott, like, I'm not an elite athlete. I mean, I'm not skating down the street with the Minnesota Wild. I'm not playing for the Timberwolves. You know, I'm a business professional. I'm an entrepreneur. How does this apply to me? And what you come to realize is that the same set, actually, of skills and principles that allow these athletes to be successful, to be focused, to be resilient, the same team dynamics, the same leadership characteristics that you see in sport and athletics are the same things that allow us to not only get the best out of ourselves, but also to get the best out of other people. And really, that's what I'm going to share with you today, is I obviously don't have a ton of time to be able to talk. This is going to be a slightly different presentation that I normally do, where I am going to be talking about some different things in regards to mindset, in regards to routines, in regards to leadership, and in regards to being resilient and positively responding to adversity. But the first thing that I usually speak to people about is that what I'm going to tell you is not, I'm not going to have any complex algorithms, I'm not going to have any fancy formulas or anything like that. A lot of what I say, believe it or not, is common sense. But what I often will also say is that what's common sense is not common practice. So you all have handouts on your table. I'll kind of walk you through it as I go through the course of the presentation. But really my main goal in doing any of these presentations is to provide as much value as I possibly can and to give you strategies that you can implement into your life immediately. Like when you walk out the door, something where you're like, you know what? No, I could be doing that a little bit better. I can use that right now. So really, that's the goal of the next 40 or so minutes. And when we look at outperforming the norm, I want to kind of anchor in where I'm coming from when it comes to outperforming the norm. And the definition of outperform is just to surpass in excellence of performance or to do better than. And back when I first got started in sports psychology, we used to talk about in two different types of what we would call orientations. And when you look at high achievers, whether we're talking about in athletics or whether we're talking about in business, like how are they wired? What is their psychology? Well, the two different types of orientations, one is what we call an ego orientation. Or it's basically like, it's kind of me against you. It's looking at other competitors and it's saying, you know what, how can I gain a competitive advantage over them? If I'm running in a marathon against Chum, it's me saying I want to cross the finish line faster than her. It's basically you kind of against other people. And when you look at high achievers, are they wired with a certain amount of that competitive urge and that competitive desire? Absolutely. But then the second part of it is what we call a mastery orientation. And if you really look at the people that end up being very successful in business, in life, in athletics, or in anything else, they have just a burning desire and wake up every single day thinking about, you know what, how can I be just a little bit better today? Like, how can I level up my own individual performance? So, you know, we spoke before, I think about the conversation we had about patents and people going, and you know what, when you get to a certain level, people will start to rip off what you're doing in China and they will kind of, I guess, steal from you and create knockoff products. Well, the mastery orientation part of it would look at and would say, okay, certainly do I want to do everything in my power to prevent this from happening? Absolutely. But you'd be looking at it and you'd be saying, you know what, sometimes if you're looking too far outside of yourself, you're looking at the wrong thing. So it would be saying, how can I make my product so good, or how can I continue to refine it, to enhance it, and make it so almost impossible to duplicate that nobody else can do it? So hopefully that makes sense. And to just start off, you know, I'm such a big believer in mindset. And I'm just going to pose the question to you guys. And if any of you have heard me speak before, you can answer this. How many thoughts do you think the average person has every single day? You speak up a little bit, whoever said that?
I said about 40,000.
Okay, it's a little bit more.
Well, a woman has more than a man.
I'm not touching that one with a 10-foot pole. Yes, you are right. It's about 50,000 thoughts a day is what the average person has. So another follow-up question to that is, again, when we talk about mindset, when we talk about psychology and how to get the best out of ourselves, is of those 50,000 thoughts, what percentage of those, again, speaking in terms of averages, do you think are negative? It's about 80%. So 40,000 out of our 50,000 thoughts. And again, we're here at Club Entrepreneur. We've got some very successful people in the room. So I'm betting you're probably below that average. But I think as you go out and you influence and impact the world, and as you come into contact with peers and the people within your company, it's important to understand that sometimes we see the glass as more half empty than half full. So if 80% of those thoughts are really negative or glass half empty, why do you think that is? Like, what's driving that? What's driving our half empty? Yes. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And I have someone say that probably at every presentation or speech that I do. And first off, there are no right or wrong answers here. This is a safe place here at Club Entrepreneurs, so you don't have to worry about being right or being wrong. But it's actually interesting that you say that, because one of the last things I'm going to talk about is change and how we can actually positively thrive through change, because change isn't going away anytime soon. And I do think that there's a fear-based component. So I certainly think you can look at that. I think from a psychological perspective, you can certainly look at it as conditioning as well, where I'm a big believer that you condition the mind like you condition the body. And you look at it, I mean, let's just say like leading up to the election that we had last November, it's well documented that we pay 10 times more attention to negative news than we do positive news. And there's a reason why so much of the media and so much of what's going on out there is talking about what somebody's doing wrong versus what somebody's doing right. And I'm just a huge believer that when we're constantly exposing ourselves to this, it does really affect us over time. And the first part on the top of your handout, just so we're all kind of following along here, the reason that this is so important and the reason that I start with this is it's the basic premise that thoughts affect feelings, which affect behaviors. That's the progression. And you can look at it on so many different levels. I'm not happy with where I am. I feel bad. I eat ice cream. You know what? I feel really good about the progress that I'm making. I'm energized, I'm motivated, I go out and I'm productive at work. You've got this progression, and so often we want to look at it, and we're going to talk about routines after this, but so often we want to look at just the behaviors and the actions and the things that we do on a day-to-day basis. And what I'm telling you is if whether it's been you or anybody else that you've ever managed or worked with or just come across, you're like, I don't know why, I just can't get this person to be more motivated or to do this thing or to make this certain action. Well, what actually precedes that is literally the physiological emotions going on throughout your body. And what precedes that is some type of mindset or some type of barrier that's holding you back. So I'm not going to talk a lot more about mindset throughout the course of this presentation, but the basic question that I ask is, again, starting out working with athletes, is golf was my first love. And you know what? I mean, we were talking before. You're out there, let's say you're out there for a 4.5 to 5 hour round. You spend less than 2 minutes actually swinging the golf club. Like, the rest of the time is thinking about the shot you just hit or the shot you're going to hit or some other irrelevant thing. But I will oftentimes ask, whether it's a class I'm teaching, sports psychology at St. Olaf, or any group that I'm speaking to, like, name off a different sport. What percentage of that do you think is mental? And I've asked it in regards to any sport, and it's always either 60% or above is due to mental factors and is due to the mindset you have. And if I were to just ask you what percentage of your business success and of your ability to be a successful entrepreneur is going to be due to your mindset and how you manage that, what would you tell me? And that's why we start here. That's mindset. So to shift gears from that, one of the principles I always talk about and outperform the norm is what I call attack. And I kind of say, you know, that's kind of a strong word, like attack, but it's basically like you go out there and you attack the day, right? Like, seize the day. You go out there, you dictate that pace of the game. But you show me any successful person, I will show you someone that has the best habits and the best routines for success. Like, we just do. Our habits make us or break us in everything. And, you know, because we're here in St. Paul, I'm not the biggest hockey fan, but I got to include a slide on the Minnesota Wild. What will determine, you know, whether they end up winning the Stanley Cup is their habits, their routines, and their disciplines for success. And there's specific ways that we can actually build these. And lots of times, it happens to me, especially if I'm doing like a larger all-company keynote or speech, or you know, any larger engagement where I'll kind of be off to the side and everybody knows that I'm the speaker, I will almost inevitably have somebody come up to me and they'll say, you know what, Scott, like, I can't wait for you to motivate me today. Like, I really want to be motivated by you. And I always kind of chuckle because truthfully, if you're looking at motivation, yeah, you know, if I can motivate and inspire you, like, that's great. But if you're looking at motivation, you're looking for motivation, you're probably looking for the wrong thing. And I just say, do you think professional hockey players, athletes, are motivated for every practice and for every game they have to play? The same way, are we always motivated in our lives to go out and to do the things that we have to do? No, there isn't a single person on this planet that is. But they're disciplined enough to do what they need to do when they need to do it, regardless of whether they feel like it. That's basically the attack part of it. And when you look at this, there's a concept that I talk a lot about that we call the vital 4%. And if you don't know, 4% is 1 hour of your day. You know, it's a very small window of time, but I'm such a huge believer in getting off to a positive start and getting into kind of forward momentum as you start the day. I think if you own the morning and own that first hour, you are absolutely gonna own the day. So of the things and of the choices that we can make in the first hour of the day, you know, what do you think are some of the most important things that we could do to really set the tone for an outperforming day? Right. So how can you do that? Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. Absolutely. What else? What else can we do just in the first hour?
Healthy breakfast.
I won't talk about it here, but I'm a big believer that food is fuel. Yeah, it really is. And I don't think a lot of people make the connection between what they put into their body and how it impacts the way they think and feel and perform. So wake up, have 20 ounces of water, have a good healthy breakfast. If you're wondering what's healthy, you know what healthy is. You know that fresh fruit is healthier than a sausage and egg McMuffin. Like, people know that. Again, it's the gap between common sense and not being common practice, but it does impact us, absolutely. So fuel the body. What else? Workout, exercise. The single greatest performance enhancer for our lives, personally and professionally. Nothing else can duplicate the physical, mental, emotional benefits that we get from exercise. Yet it's the first thing that we oftentimes cut out when we're stressed and we're too busy. We're like, I'm too stressed, too busy, you know, I can't exercise. I got too much going on. Not really, again, realizing that it will make us better in every area of our life. What else?
Yes?
Set your goals for the day. Absolutely. Prioritize exactly what it is that you would like to accomplish. Your highest value tasks. So to give you, and it's amazing because I've asked this to so many different audiences, and again, looking at it and common sense not always being common practice, but if I were just to list out kind of the four things and the vital 4% to start every single day, to take it from the top, the fourth one would be plan out exactly what you want to get done for the day, what you want to prioritize, exercise or moving your body, fueling your body for performance. And then I will usually have someone say, you know, a positive mindset, or maybe someone will say prayer or devotions or meditation. I just call it an attitude of gratitude. That's the way I spin it. And there are more and more studies that actually show you can, they call it intentional activities. Intentional activities or simple things where you just literally wake up and make a conscious choice to wake up on the right side of the bed can level up your happiness as much as 30%. As far as that happiness and that fulfillment that you just have on a day-to-day basis. And when you wake up with that attitude, regardless if you have a bunch of change going on in your business or some adversity that you're going through, or you know, you're not exactly where you want to be yet, making that conscious choice with that attitude of gratitude as the first thing really is a big, big deal. So those are the four things. And then with that last thing, being, you know, prioritizing your highest value tasks and really looking at it and really focusing on that. I understand that we have people in a lot of different spots here, but what, And when I'm talking about this, I'm not talking about all the things that you have to do on a day-to-day basis, because I think we all have probably 50 different things that we have to do each day, right? But when the essence of this presentation is to talk about the vital few and to make a conscious effort to not make the vital few the trivial many. So when you look at it and when you say, what are the things that I really need to be excellent at or that I need to do really well for the position I'm at in my business, what would that look like for some of you guys? Like, what are some of those things off the top of your head that you just do on a day-to-day basis? Highest value tasks. Generate new customers. Are you in sales? Everyone here is in sales, I'm betting, right? That's what I say in my book. I'm like, everyone's a salesperson. You may as well embrace it. Sales is good. What else? Tasks. Respond to clients. Who said that? Yeah. Respond to clients. Follow up, absolutely. Very important if you're customer service, for sure. What else? Motivate employees. Now, can you give your employees motivation? Okay, so then what are you really giving employees? And again, there are no right or wrong answers. I'm just curious. What's that?
An example of
how to play the game. You want me to give you an example? No,
no,
oh, okay.
I'm saying
yeah.
Right,
right. Yep, we're going to talk about leadership. We're going to talk about specific ways that, I mean, you can call it motivation. It's an easy way to just say it, but to give your employees something so they want to raise their quote-unquote game and they want to play a little bit harder for you. So as you just kind of think about it, and we won't stay on this too much longer, but think about your highest value tasks and think about what really matters and what really moves the needle in terms of your business. And you know what, when we look at focusing on things, I mean, technology can be our greatest asset or our largest liability. We weren't necessarily made to be this hyper-connected to people 24/7. And when we talk about focus, like, do you know how long it takes the average person to respond to a text message? That's 40 seconds, and I'm sure it's skewed by the younger generation, but do you know how many emails the average person receives every day? It's 147. And so it's just a massive amount of, that's why I say I actually have a strategy I call the SWEPT strategy, that SWEPT being an acronym that stands for, if you want to focus and you manage your social media, your web browsing, your email, your phone calls, and your text messaging, your productivity will absolutely go through the roof. But you think about it, I mean, the time in our lives, and we're probably the most productive, where we really absorbed a lot of knowledge and really got a lot of things done, is probably when we were in school, right? But when you were doing English, you weren't doing math. And when you were doing science, you weren't doing history. You had a very targeted, singular focus on what it was that you wanted to accomplish. And again, might sound like common sense, but is it common practice for a lot of us? And I've been around a lot of high achievers, specifically, I mean, entrepreneurs, C-suite executives, senior managers, and whatnot, and I've oftentimes asked them the question, other than first thing in the morning when a lot of those guys are very productive, when else is the most productive time for you? And what do you think they tell me? What's that? Some of them say that, but it's not the one that I hear the most. What's that? When they're on an airplane. Why? Why would they say that they're so productive when they're on an airplane? No distraction. What else? Yeah. Yeah. And it's not always true, but I heard it so often that I actually just came up with my own strategy called airplane mode. And you don't need to be on an airplane to use it and for you to implement it into your day-to-day life. But you look at the conditions that kind of create, let's say, peak productivity in airplane mode. One, it is typically being unplugged. It's being unplugged from the world around you, so you're very proactive with your activity instead of reactive. Two, you probably know exactly what it is that you want to accomplish. You know, my girlfriend lives out in Denver, Colorado. I know it's a two-hour flight. I know what I need to accomplish when that plane touches down. And then you also have built-in urgency for what it is that you're doing, because legitimately you can see the flight timer counting down and you have to mobilize your efforts and mobilize your focus towards what it is that you're doing. And you think about just those three conditions, and I get that we have people in a lot of different spots here, but I am telling you that it can have a massive effect on your productivity. And I don't know if you can dedicate 1 hour a week to quote-unquote being in airplane mode, or if it can be a half hour a day, or how it works out in your schedule, but I'm telling you, if you really want to get something done and you create that singular focus, you will absolutely flip the lid on what you're doing in terms of the amount you're getting done. But we're so hyper-connected, and if you know any study on neuroscience or anything else, you know that we actually can't multitask. We can only single task. We can't do two things really well at once. Yet we always want to. So it's just food for thought. So to shift to the leadership part of it, we're talking about good old Bud Grant. We got any Vikings fans in here? Hope we have Vikings fans in here. Does anybody recognize this picture as we talk about leadership? Usually somebody recognizes it. What is it? Yep, so it wasn't this past season, but it was the season beforehand. For you Vikings fans, I don't know if you remember how that ended for us, but unfortunately, we got beat by the Seattle Seahawks in our first playoff game. But if you remember that game, we were playing outdoors at TCF Bank Stadium because US Bank was being built, and brutally cold day. It was the coldest game in Vikings history, dating all the way back through when we played at the Met. It was the third coldest game in NFL history. I think it was single digits below zero, wind chill was roughly 15 below. An 88-year-old Bud Grant comes out there, and I mean, Bud Grant is just so badass. Like, he's so much tougher than I am, and I readily admit it, but former coach for the Vikings, and he comes out there, and he's going to be the guy that walks out to the 50-yard line for the coin toss, for the ceremonial coin toss to decide which team is going to kick and which one's going to receive. And remind you, it's 15 degrees below zero. And he's standing next to Roger Goodell, the commissioner of the NFL. And he takes off his jacket right before, because there's been a lot of talk before the game on, you know what, I don't know how the Vikings are going to handle the cold. Like, I don't know if they're going to be able to take it. And we'd gotten killed by the Seattle Seahawks a couple of weeks before that. So right before he walks out there, he takes off his jacket, hands it to the commissioner of the NFL, and says, "Here, son, hold on to my jacket for me." And he says, which I love that he's calling the commissioner of the NFL son, but he says, "Here, son, hold on to my jacket." And he says, "Because I want to show everyone that the cold doesn't bother the Vikings." And I heard that, and I was like, that is just a priceless thing. Like, the cold doesn't bother the Vikings. And sure enough, he walks out there, and it became this huge, like, internet sensation. But when we look at the first basic principle of leadership, it's just simply leading by example and being the person that, you know, I'm not telling all of you to stop wearing jackets and walk into the office in January without a jacket on, thinking that that's leading by example. But at the time, it was just him basically saying, you know what, that's enough with all of this other stuff. We're going to show up. We're going to play this way. And whether it had an effect or not, I don't know. We played a really good game, and we really should have won it. But I thought it was such a priceless example of, again, that leading by example. And let's just say that you're not all that comfortable with kind of being that person that goes out and does something like that. I want to walk you through a strategy that I've used with a lot of high achievers, whether we're talking about athletes or whether we're talking about business leaders, and it's what we call an on-field identity. Some people would actually call it an alter ego. But basically what it is, and we all have these things where we all have insecurities, we all have worries, we all have some type of fear of being judged, you know? Like, Not to call out what you said to me, but I hear people say this all the time. You're like, well, I'm not a speaker, or I'm not a very good speaker. I'm like, what are you talking about? You speak every day. We all speak every day. Yet somehow when we stand up here in front of a crowd and we're being evaluated or we worry about being judged, our performance changes. So when we talk about creating something like an on-field identity, is this something that you need to use 24/7? No. But I'm guessing there are certain tasks and certain things related to your business where you need to quote unquote be on stage, and you really need to bring it, and you really need to show up, and you need to be the best version of yourself. So I just want to do a little exercise with you guys for the on-field identity before I flush this through a little bit. Take your hand out. And I want you to just write down who is one leader or one mentor or somebody in your life where you're like, you know what, I really look up to that person. It can be in any area. I mean, you can name an athlete if you wanted to, or somebody in business, or might be a mother or father. But somebody in your life that you really look up to, and why do you look up to them? Like, what specific characteristics do they possess? I want you to write that down and then just pair up with someone to your left or right, and I want you to take a couple minutes just discussing that. Make sense? Go ahead. Let's just take about one more minute, okay? What was that about saying? Okay. Yeah. My brother played football for St. Olaf, and you guys always whooped up on him. So. Yeah, there is. All right, everybody, let's bring it back in, please. I just got to make sure I respect your time and I don't go over. So can we all circle back? Come on, entrepreneurs. I know we like to talk, but... Okay, so can I get a couple of examples on people that you named and what specific characteristics they displayed that either you try to emulate in yourself or you're really striving to be like? Yes, thank you. Yeah. Yeah. Good. Great. Good. What else? Trump.
I always say first that I don't like everything about her. I don't. But what I do like about Madonna is that she's really confident. She's bold. She's fearless. She is a trendsetter, and she's not scared to do whatever she wants.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great example, actually, and it's interesting that you bring her up. And as you kind of think through people, you're not necessarily trying to be everything about that person. Like, I mean, I grew up in the heyday of Michael Jordan, and I was a huge Michael Jordan fan, had his pictures taped up in my bedroom and would follow everything that he was doing. And when I think about kind of pressure situations where I need to get up and speak or do something, I think about specific characteristics that he displayed. But do you know, have you heard like the story with Beyonce in regards to this? It's interesting, I just heard it a couple of weeks ago. Regardless of whether you're a Beyonce fan, most of you probably know who she is. But the deal with her is that she actually created an alter ego or an on-field identity called Sasha Fierce. That is actually one of her albums because she's inherently a shy person. And shy doesn't work that well when you need to get up on stage, you need to perform in front of hundreds of millions of people. And she wanted to create something where she could go out there and she could be more free and more spontaneous when she was performing. And inevitably when I talk about this, some people either ask me or they're thinking it. They're like, well, Scott, is this gonna make me fake? Like, am I gonna be fake if I try and do this? And the answer is absolutely not. What we're actually doing is we're taking things that are already inside of you and you're making a very conscious effort to enhance that and to bring those things out to make you better at the task at hand. And high achievers in sports and in business are really good at this, where they're able to say, you know what, I might not be all that comfortable getting up and doing this presentation, this sales presentation, or going up and leading this all-company conference or conference call or whatever it happens to be. We all have these things that are a little bit uncomfortable for us. And that's when you call on something like this to be able to raise your game and to be able to make you better. I could really go in depth into this concept, but the one way that you do it is you pair it with some type of trigger. It can be something that, it can be like clothing or something, because I oftentimes say fashion is a feeling. Like it can just be a game day suit or a game day dress that like you only wear it when it's game day. And the same way that a Minnesota Viking will put on the pads and the helmet and they know it's game day and they become a different person when they step out onto the field, the same thing happens with you. It could be a specific pen that you use. It could be a song that you listen to that's just a song that evokes an emotion that triggers something that leads you to think about the characteristics of the person that you want to emulate. So I hope this makes sense because it is a very intentional act of just enhancing what you're doing and raising your game that way. And it's no small thing. It really can help. And then as far as getting the best out of others, couple quick things just to go over. How many people have heard of the sandwich approach? Imagine a lot of you, because we're talking about giving feedback and motivating team members and things like that. There's an approach called the sandwich approach. And one thing that I oftentimes say is, a good line to use is there is no failure, there's only feedback. And to remember that, and whatever business you're a part of, it's what I call playing to win instead of playing not to lose. If you're going out there and if you're afraid of making a mistake, you're never going to be able to grow at the rate that you want to go. And when you look at feedback, for those of you that aren't familiar with the sandwich approach, basically the bread on the sandwich is your positive reinforcement or what someone is doing really well. The meat or kind of the guts, the inside of the sandwich, is your constructive criticism or what you would like for the person to do better. So what is the specific reason that we do something like the sandwich approach? Like, why do we do that? Exactly, yes. Or the constructive criticism, as I would call it. But yeah, absolutely. I mean, you have to, and I'm sorry, I got asked, it probably started about a year ago, I've been getting asked more and more to do presentations on millennial management. And you know what, there's 50 million plus, I am actually a millennial, born in 1980. There are 50 million plus millennials out there in the workforce and it's only getting bigger. And they were raised on a lot more positive reinforcement. And if you're going out there and if you're just using sticks all the time and you're never using carrots, what happens is people get so afraid of making a mistake that they can't quote unquote go out there and play their game anymore. So you actually just reinforce with something and then come back to, okay, I think we can do this a little better, and then end with reinforcement. But do you have to use a sandwich approach in every single circumstance? No, but what I will tell you is that research on the best leaders out there show that they almost always use at least a 2-to-1 or a 3-to-1 ratio of positive feedback to negative feedback. You gotta hit those ratios if you really wanna get the best out of people. And then the formula below that, if you just look at the acronym CAR, but basically the C plus A equals R, that's clarity plus awareness equals results. And when we're talking about clarity and awareness, we're talking about roles. So you look at what the best leaders do. Clarity is clarity of expectations. You know, like if I were to go and ask people, whether it's direct reports or people in your company, do you know exactly what's expected out of you? What would they tell me? And the answer, surprisingly, is a lot of times they don't. Like, they don't really know exactly what the expectations are for them. Those have to be clarified, they have to be communicated. And the awareness part of it, the role awareness, is how valuable the person is to the entire team. So you even look at it like New England Patriots just won the Super Bowl, okay? And you've got superstar quarterback Tom Brady. Well, what Bill Belichick, their coach, is going to do better than anyone else is he's going to make everyone feel valuable, from Tom Brady, the superstar quarterback, all the way down to the last person on the practice squad. The same way that the great businesses make everyone feel valuable, and it's one of the biggest reasons that people leave is because they don't feel appreciated. So how can you make people feel valuable? How can you make them feel appreciated, regardless whether they're on the ground level or whether they're your A player? They all matter. That clarity plus awareness equals results. And the last point that I'll talk about is what I call conquer. I won't go into a lot of this, but you heard that I ran a 100-mile ultra marathon when I got introduced. If you want to know what it looks like afterwards, I don't know if you can see it, but that's me hunched over on a bench. It's about 10 after 3 in the morning, ran for a little over 21 hours straight. I'm taking the headlamp off of my head, and I'm just absolutely so tired that I can't even sit up straight. But when we talk about conquer, conquer is not only our ability to positively respond to adversity and to be resilient and to set big challenges for ourselves, but is also how do we manage and how do we respond to change and how do we thrive through that? Because whether we're talking about running 100 miles or growing a business or anything else, I can tell you that it was a huge roller coaster. It's never a train ride. Like, you're gonna have lots of ups and you're gonna have many more downs, and it goes like this. So it's being able to manage those things. And really, well, I should say this first. So confidence is really what we're talking about when it comes to this. This is a quick shot of, I took the top 20 articles when I just Googled traits of high-performing business leaders. I took all the text from the different articles, I pasted it into a word cloud, and this is what it came up with. Basically, the bigger the word, the more times it was mentioned, the more important it is. So really, confidence is one of those traits that we absolutely have to have, and I think confidence and faith and belief is what allows you to get through a lot of this. But when you look at it, the biggest thing, as simple as it sounds, again, common sense not always being common practice, but I think this speaks back to the fear that we talked about initially when we were talking about our thoughts, the 50,000 thoughts a day. We are hardwired, actually biologically, to think that change means worse because it's uncomfortable for us. Like, we perceive it as a threat, and anytime something is going on, we want to perceive it as threatening. And I think about, you know, I was speaking engagement for a large group of financial advisors, would have been, I guess, a week and a half ago. And I'm not going to name the company, but they're going through a lot of different changes, bigger changes than they probably had in the last 30 years. And some people are pretty uncomfortable about it, you can imagine, right? It's the one thing that I hear from every single company that brings me in to work with them or speak is, we're going through a lot of change and some of our people are struggling to deal with it. And it's just simply this, because change, they think it means worse. So it's constantly reiterating, in any change that's going on, there are always some opportunities that are becoming available. And there are some things that, believe it or not, it can actually be better. So it's reminding yourself of that. And then as far as thriving through change, if I'm just talking to individuals, I call it P3, or I call it a personal power phrase. But if you're looking at what you can do for your team, if you look at really creating a culture of people, like where they really just rally and they positively respond to change, whatever is going on, adopt some type of rallying cry or something that you can always come back to. So what does this look like? I think about last year, I did a year-long engagement with a medical device company. And one of the regions, the central region, it's kind of blunt, but I'll just tell you what it is. They had a slogan they just used called Pissed Off for Greatness. Like, Ray Lewis, this linebacker, some of you might know who he is. Ray Lewis is a Hall of Fame linebacker in the NFL. He has a YouTube video out there where he just talks about how you got to be pissed off for greatness. Like, you got to really want it. And this region adopted it as their thing, where it was just their rallying cry. And they went through a ton of changes, were restructured a couple of times, really tough year. And whether it's because of the rallying cry, I don't know, but that region ended up dominating the other regions because every time something bad would happen, they would come back to something like that and they'd be like, doesn't matter, man, I'm pissed off for greatness. Like, and they would all rally around that. It was the coolest thing. And this has to be something, this is not your mission statement, this is not your vision statement. Those are good things that communicate why you do what you do and where you're going. But this is something that behind closed doors, like where your people are going, you know what? Like PJ Fleck from Minnesota, it's row your boat, you know? Bill Belichick for the New England Patriots, it's no days off. But it's something that regardless of what people are going through, you have that rallying cry. It unites people on a team. It makes you distinct as far as what you're doing, and it helps you move forward, whatever you're going through. So that's the rallying cry. So to close this out, just the last two things. If you would like a copy of not only these slides, but also the handouts that go along with it, and get on my weekly email list where I send out strategies not only to help you get the best out of yourself, but also things that you can help, that you can use to get the best out of others. All you need to do is text the word outperform to 38470. I know Chum's on the list, some of you others might be already. But I really do try to send out things of value every single week to make you better. So that's outperform to 38470. And to close this out, you know, sometimes we get kind of stuffy and buttoned up when we're talking about business presentations. And I'm going to just end this with a personal story of mine. So my mother passed away last week, 9 days ago. Funeral was on Friday. Throat cancer, where she was diagnosed. Well, we brought her into the hospital 3 days after Christmas. New Year's Eve is when she was officially diagnosed. So she was basically around for 2 months this year. And when I talk about a lot of these things, you know, are we obviously talking about growing a business and revenue and targets and metrics and sales and all these things? Yes. But I look back and I just think about, you know, they were in Albany, Minnesota. I don't know how many of you know where Albany, Minnesota is, but it's a small town. It's about 2,000 people. My parents have lived there all their lives. And they had a massive number of people come out for the funeral. Like, I couldn't believe the number of people that came out. And you can't help but go through something like that and think about what is the impact and what is the influence that I want to have on the world. And we talk about mindset. You talk about, she was a teacher, and the number of people that came through that were like, God, your mom had such an impact on me, or God, I met her and she always treated me this way. You know, if there's one lasting message that I would love to leave with you, you know, this, some of my greatest times with my mom, that's this from 1998, it's from a golf tournament where I just think back to, you know, the times where we would just drive to different golf tournaments and we would just talk as mother and son, and I'm gonna miss her. And I mean, you can look at it from a gratitude perspective where you gotta be thankful for what you got because you never know when it might leave you. But I think you can also look at it and you can think about waking up every single day and what is the impact you wanna have on people's lives and what is the legacy you wanna leave. So I wanna thank you all very much for your time and attention. I wish you all the best going forward. Good luck and God bless.
Thank you so much, Scott. I've heard a lot of speakers in my time, and I really, really enjoyed that and took a lot away, and I know others did too. So thank you, everyone else, for coming as well and being with us, and we hope to see you again. So thank you.